What I've heard is Ben is very good at constituent services, and so if you have questions, other councilmen send their constituents to Ben. So let's thank Ben for here for coming.
Good afternoon. Okay, so you're going to say it back to me, so good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Okay, and we just need a little bit more energy. I know it's the end of the day, but we're here at Google. There's free food. We have great organizers. Good afternoon!
Good afternoon!
Thank you. So I want to just thank Ralph and the other organizers of the Google Developer Group for making this happen. So I'm council member Ben Kallos, and you can find me on Twitter, at Ben Kallos on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and GitHub. I also have other non-government GitHub identities, but that's the one that you can use. So please make sure to send your, engage in the conversation if you don't have a chance to have questions, or at least as you're listening and watching. And just so you know, we're recording this. I try to put everything online. We have a whopping 10 followers on our YouTube channel, I believe in doing the right thing, and so you should be able to see what your government officials say. So now the next thing is take your phones out, only Android phones, only hold up Android phones. We're here at Google. If you have an iPhone, it's not welcome. Sorry, please go to the Apple meetup, I want to see you folks typing away, because that's how we listen in our generation. It's how we make sure that we spread the message beyond the folks who just happen to be here in the city and in this room. So I will know that I did well if folks are tweeting about this conversation. If you're not, I know that I may be one of your more boring speakers, which is fine. So just make sure to tweet at Ben Kallos or Facebook or Instagram, you name it. So I wanted to just take a moment to talk about things. So Ben Kallos, I live in New York City, and I want my voice to be heard, but I feel like no one is listening. I feel like government is broken. And so we live in a democracy. So what is a democracy, you might ask? So I figured, why not make sure that my computer is responding to the slides. So give me a moment. Not responding to the Control-Alt-Delete. So let's figure out why. I'm just trying to get any response out of my computer, which locked up. So it's fine. Who needs a presentation? Josh, if you can play with my computer while I continue to speak. So in terms of democracy, we might think it feels a little bit broken. One of the reasons democracy might be broken is because it's rule by the people, democracy. And so there's two reasons why that might be happening. One reason might be because the people aren't involved. So there's three folks in the room who know what a council member was before. So I imagine most of you haven't picked up your phone and called your council member. How many people have called an assembly member? Okay. How many people have called a state senator? How many folks have called their Congress member? Okay. U.S. senator. And how many folks have sent angry emails at the president? Sure. Give me 1 second. So Josh, take this, play with it. Okay. So democracy is somewhat broken, and in one sense it's because people aren't involved, but a lot of folks reach out to me and ask, how do I get involved? And on that flip side, even if you do want to get involved and you know who your council member is and who all your elected officials are, it's really hard to be involved. So in both ways, government is broken, and it actually has a really broken feedback loop in that when somebody does connect and get what they want, they don't continue, right? So if you want a new park, you get your new park. Thanks, ta-ta, I have better things to do. If you want a new park and you don't, thanks, F you, I have better things to do. Either way, the end is a disconnect. And how many folks think that is a good system for users? Anyone designing systems where once they're good the users stop using your service. So that's one of the challenges, and so it looks like things are back. So give us a second. I got it. So the solution in this case, as in many cases, was did we try turning it off and on again? And so when you're trying to figure out how to get involved, you should probably apply the same methods that you use for your business plan. How many people have had to do a business plan before? So I think you know some of the questions, which is, what problem do I want to solve? Who's my audience? Who's my user? What skill sets or resources do I need to solve this problem? Who has the resources that you need? And hashtag winning. What does winning look like? What is your exit strategy? And your exit strategy can't just be get bought by Google, if anyone watched that South Park episode. And so that takes some introspection. But I think just to channel a quote from Theodore Roosevelt of Squire Bill Widener, which is, do what you can with what you got where you are. And so a lot of people have been asking me, how do I get involved? Where you're all software developers, and our government is incredibly broken, and it used to be one of the killer apps, but I'm asking you to apply your skills. And so this is one of those things where if you're a writer, use your words. If you're an artist, tell your story. But if I ask you, I want you to go show up at a protest for the next 3 hours, you're sitting there being like, I could have written an MVP that could fix something in those 3 hours. And especially with the number of people in this room, I have confidence that your time is best using your skill set. And so please consider doing that. Other pieces are trying to figure out different pathways. And so one key pathway is issue and political advocacy. So maybe an issue that speaks to you is reproductive rights. Either side of the equation, for me, I'm in favor of a woman's right to choose. In terms of women, making sure women have access to reproductive rights, making sure that women should actually get paid the same as men. How many folks think that that should be a thing? I should see every hand in here. Also, making sure we protect our immigrants. Anyone here at a firm that uses H-1B visas has an H-1B or has come over on an H-1B? Can I see those hands in the room? But like, we are a nation of immigrants. My wife is a developer. She's from Ukraine, and we need to welcome folks. Similarly, along the political spectrum, you've got the Democratic and Republican Party, you have the Working Families Party, you've got remnants of Occupy, you've got remnants of Tea Party, but there's room for issue and political advocacy, and in those realms, your skills are valuable. Additionally, all politics is local. You can get involved in your neighborhood association, you can get involved in your block association. Anyone a renter in the city? So for you renters, any of you got lucky and got rent-stabilized housing or something like that? Because if you did, you won the lottery, but you probably need to work with the other tenants in your building to keep your landlord from kicking you out. I wish there was an app for that. And so that's another key place, because change starts at your block, at your home. The other piece is, in New York City, we've got these things called community boards where you can come and be involved and have your voice heard. You can become a public member, you can even get appointed, you can spend 20 hours a week getting yelled at by people and then yelling at the government and trying to get them to do what they're supposed to do. I get elected, and I'm a free and open source software developer. I'm also an attorney, and I wanted to just make a key point, which is, whether you're doing software code or legal code, it's pretty much instruction sets that you need for operating. So anyone have an LLC or a partnership, and you have these bylaws that you argue with your partners about every now and then? So those are just a rule set written by a lawyer, a different type of software, a different type of code writer, to govern how you and your colleagues and how your partners act. And so very similarly. And so I get elected and I want to start changing the law. That's why I'm here. And so just as a background, so we have this legal code. It's about, goes back to 1750 BC when Hammurabi put it on a stone, literally. And ignorance of the law was no excuse because it was there. And 1872, these group of hackers called West Publishing started publishing legal decisions and selling them to people. By 1990, thereabouts, I was having trouble sourcing this date, they become the official publisher. And today, if I want to have access to the laws that I need to edit, I need to pay a fee to Westlaw or LexisNexis. And has anyone ever been to either of those websites in this room? Okay, that's more, and are you lawyers or you just wanted to know what your laws were? Okay, so one lawyer, five developers, you wanted to know what your laws were, you went there, and then you're like, cool, let me use this. No, no, no. There's something called a copyright, but you can't copyright government publications except for most of the time. So how are they doing it? They do this thing called copyright by license. By virtue of visiting their website, you've agreed to their copyright, and you're not allowed to use that stuff. And so as a free and open source software developer, we start with the four essential freedoms. And you all know them, but the one I'll focus on is it's not even a freedom. It's a precondition to the freedoms, which is access to the source code is a precondition to freedom. Not free as in beer, but free as in liberty. And what do you call it? Should I have had Richard Stallman's picture here, or was the GNU enough? Stallman? Okay. Folks, the GNU was fine. And so I actually wanted to get this done, and the vendors were saying that they didn't want to do it. So I got a bunch of legislators from all over the country, from Cambridge, from San Francisco, from Chicago, together along with small groups like Sunlight Foundation, OpenGov, Participatory Politics Foundation, and MIT Media Lab. And we got it together and said, you know what? If the private sector won't open this up, we will build it ourselves. And so if you're interested in that, we're interested in working with you. But one of the things that we did is when I first got elected is I wanted my legislation to be open to you. So I post my legislation on GitHub as best I can. Anyone's interested in helping, our GitHub repo is old. It's not well maintained. I am now legislating. I don't get as much chance to code. My communications director, Josh, is amazing, but he's not a software developer. He's a TV guy. And that's one of the things that we deal with, which is the technology skill sets, unless one of you is willing to quit your job making a lot of money or having the potential of making a lot of money to get paid far, far less in public service, we're not going to, government won't be able to meet you in the digital plane. So the legislation is now online. We put a part of it as requiring an open API. We're still trying to get that in 4 years in, but hopefully you'll be able to track legislation that you care about. Somebody who is doing great work on that is David Moore at Participatory Politics Foundation. You can check out Councilmatic, where you can actually pay attention. You can set alerts on bills you care about. And what he does is he works with Sunlight Foundation. They scrape the city council website every day and then pop it into an open API and then pull data onto it into Councilmatic. So we got the open legislation right off the bat. We also passed Local Law 37 of 2014, which actually said that the law had to be available for free, and it had to be available over open API. So that's cool, we did this 2014. And has anyone ever responded to a request for proposals? I see one, a couple of hands. So an RFP is basically written by a bunch of lawyers who don't actually know anything about the law that got passed. And so they issued an RFP. I didn't know about it. I had the luck of asking them in a hearing. They're like, oh yeah, it's due in April. And I was like, can I see it? And they were like, no. I mean, sure. So they sent it to me a week later. And in the RFP, it said that whoever bid on making this available, because why should the city make our laws available when we can pay a vendor to do it for us? The vendor had to, on its proposal, explain how are they going to make money by selling the code. Anyone think that there's a problem with a vendor having to make money by selling code they're supposed to give for free? So that's what we call a conflict of interest in my business. So I asked them to remove that section and reissue the RFP. But the RFP was in something called the city record. And so This is the city record. It gets published every single day. It's about 40 pages, and it's incredibly user-friendly. And we're going to actually visit the city record in a moment. But anyone here read the city record? Anyone knew about it beforehand? I see Ralph raising his hand and somebody in the back. The city record is the most important newspaper in the city of New York that you have never heard of. This newspaper is where government tells you that they're going to demolish your home and replace it with a highway. This is the equivalent of leaving something at Alpha Centauri if you're going to demolish the Earth for an intergalactic highway. And so the way you know that they were going to demolish your house for this highway is it was in the city record. Why didn't you know it was in the city record? Because you didn't do your civic duty of reading this newspaper every single day to see if there was something relevant in it. And they do it, they don't tell you your address. They tell it by your, Ralph was just pointing out, they do it by your block and lot. So for those of you who, does everyone know their address in New York City? Good. Does everyone know their block and lot? So Ralph does, three of you do. So I would recommend setting an alert on your block and lot on the city record site so that when somebody's planning to do something to your block and lot, if they, God willing, list it by block and lot, you can find out about it. And so I just want to put one challenge out here, which is we need to convert legal code to computer code so computers can convert it into plain language. And so I noticed that some of the topics today involved artificial intelligence and other pieces. So let me just, I realize now that when my system went down, so did the city record. But let me just take a moment, and I know I'm getting over time. So this is the city record online site. They have a GUI for things. It's also available in open data. And so let me just pull up the print edition because that's what they sent to my office. And we're going to go with February 3rd because it's right near when my birthday is. And so this is what our city record looks like. And so the first piece is, it looks like they're putting in a historic district, Sullivan Thompson Historic Districts. Anyone know about Sullivan Thompson Historic District? Okay, well, it's really simple because it is it's a property bounded by a line beginning on the southern curb line of West Houston Street at a point of a line extending northerly from a portion of the eastern portion of 152-154 Thompson Street, then extending. And it keeps going and going for pretty much a page. So the first question is, can we draft a natural language processor that actually can take a notice like this that has been written by a lawyer to fulfill 19th century notice requirements so that we could actually just get a GIS map that you could then put online, and if somebody's location is within that, they get a notice. So that's one key piece, and then when we speak more about language, let me just find another quick example, because I like to be the one who translates this for you. So, in the matter of an application submitted by Canal Associates LP pursuant to Section 197C and 201 of New York City Charter for the grant of a special permit pursuant to 74-781 of the Zoning Resolution to modify the, and it keeps on going, and this is just so that the person can modify their first floor. That's it. And I've actually noticed since I've been doing this dog and pony show, they've actually change some of the places, so it actually just says, at this address, we're asking for a sidewalk cafe. But the big ask here is, and I'm old. I did not learn about machine learning when I took computer science back in the aughts. It's fun to feel old at 36. But what I would propose as an old man here is just using Python to pull down the information, identifying the patterns, finding the most common 100 phrases that are used, use that to identify the variable data, then sit down with that information. So day one of the hackathon is that. Day two of the hackathon is bring in urban planners, bring in lawyers, bring in law students, bring in folks to translate it from technical legal code into English, and do that for the top 100 because maybe that should cover 80% of the use cases. Then, day three of the hackathon, bring software developers who can then convert the legal to plain language to computer so that we can do cool things with it, because what I would like is to have government in my pocket. Not necessarily my pocket, but your pocket, instead of the lobbyist's pocket, because they're the ones who are paying attention. And so some legislation that we've put in is, give me a second. So some of the legislation that we're working on is open FOIL. Anyone familiar with freedom of information law? So there's this law that says that all the government information belongs to you, or belong to us. And so this would allow you to have an open portal where you could put in your FOIL request and just get the information, and when they didn't respond to you, everyone would see it. And there's a certain shame factor when people are ignoring you and not doing their jobs. Additionally, we have another bill which is to make government work a little bit differently. How many of you for work still spend hours of time filling out paperwork and then taking that piece of paper and moving it somewhere else? I see two hands, but is that a good use of your government money, of your tax dollars? So one of the ideas is something called automatic benefits. So if Google knows that my wife went shopping for red pants, and I will see red pant ads for the next 3 days no matter what I do, please don't use my Chrome if my wife is watching on YouTube, but if Google can do that, I have so much more information about you than Google does, because you pay your taxes. Anyone who doesn't pay your taxes, just let me know. The IRS is waiting outside. But so we know whether you're married. We know your marital status. We know who you're married to. We know where you live. We know whether or not you rent or own. We know what kind of property you own. We know if you're a small business person. We know a lot. And even if you don't file taxes, you're getting a W-2, or you're getting a 1099, or what have you. So we can take that information and actually just send somebody an EBT card in the mail and say, based on our information and your tax return, you're hungry. And we have government programs to help you. And now you can take those government dollars and spend them in your local community, and that's automatic benefits, and I think that's a little bit of the future. But built into that is creating an API around government information, so we replace all the people standing at windows and all the pieces of paper with software, and then we can train those people to do so much more than move paper. So. I also just want to talk about some IRL stuff. So first Friday of every month, I meet with constituents 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. to talk about whatever they want. Second Tuesday of every month, I do brainstorming with Ben. That's where I got to see Ralph. Ralph is one of the few people where after meeting in a room like this at the United Nations, I said, hey, come to brainstorm with Ben. And he actually showed up, I think, not once but twice. I really value that. But I do this every night. I speak to hundreds and hundreds of people. And Ralph, how many of those hundreds of people showed up for an opportunity to lobby their elected official without having to pay money or anything?
That night, it was about 6 or 7.
So 6 or 7 are getting involved in their democracy out of hundreds of thousands. I represent 168,000 people. And so the other question about what's the next piece of legislation that I'm putting in, that's up to you, because I'd like to crowdsource the law. So I'd love to take some quick questions from folks. And thank you all for sitting through a boring presentation about how broken government is. Any hands? So hold on, 1, 2, 3, and I'll keep it 4, and then we'll keep going. Go.
Which is generally more effective, writing our elected officials, like actual physical old school snail mail, or calling?
So elected officials and their staff dislike letters. They dislike them a lot, and sometimes we even go as far as to call an organizer and say, please stop sending letters. Every time you do that, that's a 47-cent stamp that's coming out of our staff's budget, out of their budget line. Our mailing budget and our staff budget is one and the same. So if somebody drops 10,000 letters on us, That means an intern is now spending time data entering it, then we're doing a mail merge, and so it takes a lot longer to reply to than just an email campaign, similarly with the phone call campaign. A phone call campaign to a congressional elected or even a city council, it will bug the hell out of the staff, but it will be a different level of anger than if they have to spend time and money and resources to respond in paper. So as long as you give folks the email, most of the folks in my office are just over 30 or under 30, and so they prefer email, but phone really makes an impact. It's just most people don't have enough staff to answer the phones, so a lot of the time you may end up waiting a lot of rings or going to answering machines. In my office, we have a larger internship program than almost anyone else, and we have like 20 interns, so you can handle those phones, but most people can't. So for your best bet, it is matching residents in an elected official's district with that elected official, saying your name, that you're a registered voter, where you live in the district, and giving your email address or phone number. Because the number of people who write to me who don't live in my district, who have no say in whether or not I get reelected, who have no say in whether or not I can go to higher office, is very high. And based on the fact that they can't vote for me or anything, I care more about the 168,000 people who I represent than somebody who I don't represent now and will not represent for the foreseeable future.
Early in your talk, you talked a lot about government being broken. And my sense, and I'm hoping that you'll correct me if I'm wrong, is that government is broken in much the same way that healthcare is broken. That the people who are paying for it tend not to be the same people who are consuming it, who are served by it. And I hear your presentation, it sounds like at the level of government that you're working, that may be less true. But as you move higher and higher up, it becomes more and more true. But even I suspect at your level, the people that are making contributions to your campaign and allowing you to campaign and buy the things that you need to do in order to win elections doesn't necessarily match people who are being served or are consuming the government services.
Did everyone hear that question? In the back of the room? Yes? No? Okay.
You can
so the question is, who does your government work for? Does it work for the people, or does it work for the people writing campaign contributions? Is it as broken at my level as it is at other levels? Is that fair?
Yeah.
So really amazing question. So I'm chair of the Governmental Operations Committee. We oversee something called the Campaign Finance Board. So has anyone here ever donated money to somebody running for office in New York City? Okay. So there's five hands that went up. The first $175 that you donate in the city of New York gets matched 6-1 if you're a city resident. And what that allows people like me specifically to do is say no to transactional dollars. It means, and I actually have legislation, it's called Introduction 1130, which is our language for how do I define something, which would allow somebody to run for higher office only on small dollars. So right now, you raise 10% of your spending cap in New York City. Let's call it $200,000. So you raise $20,000. The city matches that 6-1. So you get $120,000. Now you have $140,000. But you have to spend $200,000 because the other person's going to spend $200,000. Where are you going to get the other $60,000 from? Because we only have a partial match in New York City. And so at my level, I can take a check for $2,750. The President of the United States can take a check for $4,100. The Mayor of the City of New York can take a check for $4,950. The Governor of the State of New York can take a check for $55,000. Now, quick question for you. Has anyone ever handed you $55,000 without asking you for interest in your company or something back in return? I see no hands. So it turns out people want something back for their money. I'll be honest. Even somebody who gives me $10 wants something back for their money. What I would encourage folks to do is use the data set of campaign finance data that's out there. It's not updated live. It's at nyccfb.info. Once you're there, you have to click follow the money. Once you're on that page, you can download the entire thing as an Excel database, or I think they have a SQL database export. You can definitely do a SQL export at the state level. But as you are right, if you are a tenant and you're in rent-stabilized housing, and your elected official says, I'm fighting for you and affordable housing at the same time as they just took $250,000 or more from a real estate developer, who do you think they're working for? And so I don't take money from real estate developers. I only take money from folks whose interests align with me. And I also spend a lot of time asking folks like you who don't have it to give me $10 at a time, maybe up to $175, so that I can continue to say no to special interests, because you're absolutely right. Whereas for you, you've got other things that you need to do. There is an entire industry of people who think that government is there to not only help them, or not help the greater good, but to help them personally. And that's where you see people saying, I want that nursing home over there so I can put up a building and make $100 million. And that's called Rivington. And that's a problem. And that's why I want full public matching, because elected officials should spend their time in rooms like this, or actually smaller rooms, sitting with six people like Ralph and others from the community, talking about, honestly, dog poop, potholes, parks not having nets on their backboards, because if they did that, I think they'd do a better job. Thank you.
So I really, really like your idea of having like natural language processing, because I think the biggest problem is people who can do something often don't understand the paperwork that's given their way. From a perspective of doing something actionable, if, say, we wanted to get together a bunch of people and run a one-day hackathon to build it, where would we go and how would we go about it?
Please let my office know. We'd be happy to do so. I would bring the publisher of the city record in, the Department of Citywide Administrative Services. I'd also bring in some lawyers I know called the Legal Hackers, led by Professor Jonathan Askin at Brooklyn Law School, who is on Obama's tech transition team. And literally, I'm just looking for where there's a will, there's a way. And I'd also love to see a couple of leaders forming a committee from here to work. There's also a group of civic hackers at Beta NYC. But I think the key piece I'm curious about as a computer scientist is, what is the right pathway forward? What tool set should we use? And is it brute force and Python and normalizing the database and doing that piece, or is there some part of the machine learning and AI that I'm not quite aware of yet, because it is after I finished my computer science studies? So absolutely. Do you have a follow-up?
Yeah, just quickly, what are the privacy and data implications of things like this? So if people are actually, I know there's a lot of open data stuff that you do, but how do you protect citizens' privacy if they were to actually use a voice interface to like leave questions and things like that for you?
Sure. So that's tough, because everything I do belongs to you and should belong to you. I'm a default open person. So first piece is, a lot of the time we get FOIL requests. A lot. And so we will go through 500,000 emails on my server. It's benkalos.com. We operate it as a government server. We follow all the government protocols. It's more secure than most of the government servers that I've seen. I think it's more secure than Microsoft, because we're on a open source system, and so I can see the code. But the quick thing is, general correspondence is not protected.